The audience is very prepared for this evening because I think probably 95% of them have seen the movie. So I think when we get to the end, congratulations, 4 Academy Award nominations. Congratulations. Thank you. We're going to talk about... I know you don't get enough adulation, so I wanted to give you a chance to get that kind of warm response. And so the audience, you can see how much the audience is thrilled to be here and to talk with you. I have a couple questions to get us started, but part of my goal is to get to questions from the audience as quickly as possible so that we can incorporate questions from those of you who have seen the film. And we will have microphones on either side, so when we get to that point, we'll bring a microphone to you. Well, I thought it might be interesting just to sort of start by getting a sense of the relationship between the two of you. How long have the two of you known each other? Do you remember the first time you met?
Well, I think it was at a premiere, I think a Michael Winterbottom film I bumped into you the first time in London, and just, we talked about Patrick Marber, and I said, I'd love to work with you, and you said, well, write something.
Well, I didn't mean it.
Oh, right. Okay.
He took it seriously.
But we're not really. I mean, I was on. We were on nodding terms with each other until this came along. Jeff and I wrote the script, and then Christine Langham passed it to Stephen. And so really, we've only known each other while we've worked on properly when we worked on this. So the last couple of years, really, yeah.
So you were on nodding terms. You would see each other at events, wave, smile.
Yes, I knew who he was, and I'd, you know, small talk before that, really, yeah.
Well, it's sort of an obvious question, but I think it's an interesting place to start for us to better understand your working relationship. And so I think I'll ask you, why did you want to work with Stephen Frears? Stephen, why did you want to work with Steve Coogan? What took you beyond the nodding terms to actually diving in on what ended up being this project?
Well, Stephen was, from my point of view, was like the best candidate to direct this film because all his films manage to be, you know, have substance and depth, but they're not so overly esoteric in a way that sort of is alienating, and they're not portentous, that they manage to sort of be both have substance and be populist in a way. When Jeff and I wrote Philomena, we didn't want the film to be this sort of narrow, sanctimonious, self-important piece. We wanted it to be enjoyable and accessible, but still dealing with something that was important. In that regard, he seemed very, very good, very good candidate for it. And beyond that, I started speaking to him, he sort of started picking holes in the script, really, and just saying, "What's this about? I don't understand that." I felt that he was sort of like an outside eye on the film, because I was quite familiar with the sort of Catholic culture, if you like, I sometimes took things for granted, and Stephen wanted things making clear and sort of was quite demanding and exacting in terms of clarity and efficiency and economy and all the rest of it. We did a few rewrites based on Stephen's notes on the script, and so.
Well, it makes me want to ask you, Stephen, do you remember your initial reaction to this script, and do you remember any of the early notes that you gave Steve or Jeff? Do you remember some of the things that you honed in on?
Well, I always liked the comic quality. It sort of isn't quite the way anybody ever imagines. What happens is I was asked to read the script, and then I met with Steve and Jeff and the people involved, and slowly started to understand what was inside it. The truth of the matter is that that you know what's inside all of this is really Steve. I knew nothing about Catholicism. Anything I know about Catholicism, I've learned from him. Catholicism was a completely new subject for me. But I did sense that he was an interesting fellow as well as being talented, and therefore somehow worth pursuing or worth. Judy, I knew very, very well, and in a way she could look after herself. What was new to me was Steve's character. And I always thought that he and Judy would be a very good pair. I always picked on the comic quality, the sort of odd couple, whatever you call it. That side of it I liked very, very much.
Because the subject matter was so heavy, for lack of a better word, serious? Well, is that why you dwelled on the comic?
It's a terrible thing to say, but the tragedy, first of all, Judy can do that stuff in her sleep. I mean, she's brilliant at it. But the form of putting a comedy on top of a tragedy, I found very, very appealing and very interesting. I don't mean that I'm heartless, though I am. I could see how terrible what Philomena had suffered was terrible, but then the construction of it was very, very interesting on top of that. And the more I went into it, the more I discovered Steve's invention. The more interested, the more, you're sort of lured into things.
Well, it's interesting to take that comment and now volley it back over to Steve, because one of the things that I think audiences and certainly critics, if you read the coverage of this movie and the praise for this movie, it's that people sometimes, maybe fairly or unfairly, view you for your comic work. What you're doing here is bringing a weight, a sincerity, a power to this role that is beyond the comic that Stephen Frears was trying to draw out of it. So how do you respond to sort of that notion that you might have handed him a script that was very serious, but what he wanted to sort of get
wanted both elements.
Right.
What I realized was that Steve's character and imagination informed everything. Mm-hmm. And that therefore, in a way, he was the key figure. So, there's always this endless talk about, I loathe the auteur theory. But the yes, I can't bear it. But the auteur...
We're going to come back to that. I want to talk.
The auteur of this film is Steve. In other words, it was his imagination that I had to understand and follow.
Why he was such an asset to this whole thing was because he was, as he just described, on the outside. I couldn't take anything for granted, and he made it work because he demanded clarity, and I would sometimes make assumptions about things. But to come to the point you make about it being comic, it was comic on the page from the outset. I wanted to use comedy in the script to take the, as Jeff sometimes said, take the curse off scenes, and especially when you approach moments of pathos and poignancy. If you have some comedy there, comedy that comes naturally from the relationship, because that was another point, is that Philomena and Martin were so different in their outlook, and there was a photograph of the original article I read in a newspaper 4 years ago, which had a picture of Martin and Philomena. They were so very different. I knew he was an Oxbridge-educated intellectual, and she was this working-class retired nurse. So I knew that there'd be a kind of two people knocking up against each other in terms of their world views, and could exploit that for comic effect. But the point about the comedy is that it takes the curse off those beats that we're all familiar with in films, and most people are very film literate now, even if they don't know it. They're waiting for that pivotal moment. They're waiting for that sort of that emotional beat. And sometimes, if you have comedy there, it sort of it takes the curse off that moment, because when people are laughing, they sort of take their eye off the ball, and then you can slug them with a bit of poignancy. So I wanted for a long time, I was fed up being in comedy for 20 years in the UK, it's comedy's very enjoyable, but it's ultimately not satisfying because you need to, because you want to have it. To me, it's just it's much more exciting. Comedy is a tool to broach difficult subjects, and I was and also the reason I pursued this. Wasn't just because I wanted to do something different, just to alleviate the boredom of being alive. But
was part of it.
That was part of it. But the other reason was because I was fed up of especially in comedy, this sort of acerbic postmodern irony and cynicism that pervades everything, and film especially, where modern films tend to be a triumph of style over substance, and it's all about the execution of a film and not about the content of a film. And it struck me that what was once postmodernism, what was once the avant-garde choice, was now the mainstream choice that defines most movies. And actually the most avant-garde thing you could do was talk about love, because that's something that's neglected, I think, in a lot of the media. So I wanted to do something that was just sincere, without inverted commas anywhere, and exercise my own cynicism through the character of Martin.
I want to, and we have a few clips loaded up, so every couple moments I'm going to pause, and I think this might be a natural breaking point to watch. I've got on the notes here on my phone. To watch what is...
notes are on your phone.
Yeah, it's just easier. Come on.
What America has come to.
It certainly is. Sadly, if I don't write it in my phone, I can't guarantee that I'll actually ever find it again. So this is my signal to the booth that we're about to watch a clip, and let's take a look at clip one, and then we'll talk about it. So this is the first clip in our list of three clips.
They've got omelets over there,
pancakes,
and waffles, any filling, and cereal, bacon and sausage, anything you want.
I saw.
Breakfast is included, isn't it?
It is. It's just that it's too early for me. My stomach hasn't woken up yet.
Mine wakes up before I do. I'm having a ham Swiss cheese omelet. Can I get you one?
I'm not hungry.
What about some blueberries?
Coffee?
No, thank you.
Okay, well, if you want to help yourself to breakfast over there, we have two buffets, hot and cold, fresh fruit, cereal.
She just told me.
omelets with your choice of filling.
I know exactly what's on display over there.
We also have fresh pancakes.
Thank you. Trying to have a private conversation.
My apologies, sir.
You should be nice to the people on the way up, because you might meet them again on the way down.
So, Mr. Coogan, you were just talking about the notion of these two characters kind of butting up against each other. Let me ask the two of you to talk about Dame Judi Dench and how you work together as two actors, butting up, for lack of a better word, up against each other as you're kind of defining these characters. Tell me about the work you did as a trio to sort of establish that rapport, that relationship. Was it easy? Was it challenging? What were the challenges?
I did no work.
We didn't. There's no rehearsal. We didn't.
I did no work. You have two very, very good actors. If it's written properly, they'll go for each other. I mean, I was present.
So what were you doing?
That you did. To be fair, Stephen did. I mean,
he's being modest, right?
No, I'm being absolutely accurate.
He's being mostly accurate. But the one thing he did do for me, because it was sort of new territory as an actor, and so I asked Stephen to keep an eye on me, so I wouldn't, to become too over-animated opposite this very subtle, nuanced actress called Dame Judi Dench. And he did. A couple of times what Stephen would do is, I'd say, keep an eye on me, on my face, on my mug. I said on the mugometer, as we called it. And he did, actually. What he would do is he'd say, Steve, across the crew and everything. I'd say, yeah, he'd just put his hand out and just go like this. And that was, I knew what that meant.
Yeah. But the truth is, what is interesting about these kind of films is the two people going at each other. So presumably George Cukor didn't tell Katharine Hepburn how to go to for Spencer Tracy. She sort of knew how to do it. It's the balance. So if you get the two right people in the room, if they're the wrong people, there's nothing you can do about it. But if you get the right people in the room and the writing reflects the conflict, you just sort of wind them up and go and have a lie down.
Yeah.
So when you say Stephen, when you say these kinds of films, it's really you're relying on the relationship between these two actors. So what do you sort of see as your specific role, or tell me what your is it hard to sort of restrain yourself and just sort of let them do their thing, or does that come from experience of sort of?
Well, I'm naturally lazy. But what do you mean restrain yourself?
Well, I wonder if that's something you learned along the way. For example, are there examples in your past where maybe you learned to shut up. Is that something you learned in your?
I learned to shut up.
Where did you learn that? Was there a film? Was there a moment? Was there a part?
All my life, I've been learning that. One of the first things you can easily make matters worse. Mm. You know, that seems to me fine the way it is. I could have done it upside down.
Was there a version of you as a younger filmmaker that would have meddled more? Is that what you're saying?
Only out of insecurity.
Right.
But now I'm so old, and you know, it's fine. I mean, I wouldn't know how to... This is a terribly immodest thing to say. I wouldn't know how to improve it. But maybe you all know how to...
I think if you cast it right, then...
Yeah, you cast it right, and shut up, and write it right, and then you keep out of the way.
The script was quite... exact. There wasn't, some people say, oh, did you improvise the comedy? It wasn't. It was like to the letter of the script. And it was very specific, even all the comic moments and asides and everything. And
this is the writer saying that, the co-writer saying.
But it was. Judy and I did develop a kind of rapport because we spent a lot of time in a car with each other, and we just talked a lot and chatted a lot and we joked a lot. We didn't really dwell on the script. We didn't spend hours deconstructing the script and wondering what it was about, or there was no anxiousness there. Judy, if anything, talked about anything but the script. Occasionally she might pick out a word that she thought would be better, could she substitute a word here or there, but beyond that we made each other laugh and we joked and she just almost right up until the point of when Stephen said action, so that almost conspicuously didn't talk about the script, and we just made each other laugh and joked about stuff, and so that when the cameras rolled we just sort of fell into these roles, and for me I was daunted by the prospect of acting opposite her, but you just listen to her, you learn to listen, I think.
How is the process that we're talking about now and what Stephen Frears was just saying about sort of taking a step back and letting the actors do their work. How is that different from other experiences you've had as an actor working with other directors? You don't have to name names if you don't want to, but you can. How is it different? How is his approach different from other directors you've worked with?
Well, someone like Michael Winterbottom, for example. I mean, I didn't want Michael to do this film because Michael throws the script away almost every day,
right,
and says, let's just make some stuff up. And I was damned if anyone was going to throw my script away. So I didn't want to do any improvisation in this. I wanted it because I felt we'd crafted it, you know, spent a long time choosing these words carefully. So Stephen was like, you know, the perfect person for it.
Compared with Michael Winterbottom, I'm like a man in jackboots, really, sort of dictators.
Yeah. Stephen would just say quicker or slower or louder. That's all he would really say. And sort of nudges this way, nudges that way. I mean, that's the one thing it has got in common with Michael Winterbottom is that the two of them speak very little, And I really like that. There's no meetings in the morning where we talk about what the character had for breakfast or where, you know, he grew up or whether he was bullied as a child or any of that. It's just, you know, if it's well written, that there should be, you know, the old iceberg thing about the, if you should believe that there's something beneath the surface of what you've, of what's visible, should be there anyway if you've worked at it properly before you start shooting.
I remember Angelica Houston on The Grifters saying, "We're not going to discuss motivation, are we?"
and did you? Did she want to? Are there actors that sometimes want that and you have to sort of align them or realign them that you're not going to give it to them?
I tend to avoid them. You just, if the writing's good, there's nothing else to say, really. It's not... I mean, occasionally you might have a conversation about what the scene is about, but it's really just how do you do this? And this film, it was really to do with pitch and sort of musicality. Mm-hmm. And, you know, with the actors as skillful as that, you're really checking the whole time that the pitch was correct.
That's the key. Well, Stephen told me to watch It Happened One Night, the Clark Gable, I always forget her name, what's her?
Claudette Colbert.
And said that's the kind of that was redolent of this. So talks about Frank Capra, mentioned Billy Wilder, and that I when I watch the film back now, it looks like in some ways quite an old fashioned film in a very good way, in that it looks like a.
I've never been so insulted.
It reminds me of the films that Hollywood used to make in a way, because it's about character and you can going between, you know, comedy and tragedy. It feels natural and doesn't feel like a construct. You know?
So here is a film coming out of American comedy, set in Ireland and England, and, well, a little bit in America, but whose origins are entirely in American comedy. Or a particular period of American comedy. I think that's rather interesting.
that it came from you? That it came from...
No.
You don't believe in auteurs, so we'll talk about that in a moment. But.
No, that actually, the wellspring, it all comes out of... obviously I've seen a lot of films, but yeah. Then it comes from American comedy. I've only just realized this. Incredibly profound observation, but that seems to be extremely interesting. That there should be a connection between all those things.
Are films of Q-Core or a film like It Happened One Night? Tell me about your relationship to some of those American, those distinctly American.
Well, I always like that. I always like that sort of those American comedies that Capra made, that Sturges made, right. That eventually Wilder made. And Lubitsch, of course. Mm-hmm. I always liked that very, very much.
Why?
Why?
What was it about them that struck you?
They made me laugh. They touched me. I mean, for elementary reasons, they just showed American life in a very, very attractive, enjoyable way. I can't answer your question more fully than that. So that, as you know, I mean, I grew up on the films of Billy Wilder. I don't know what to say, really. I just like them.
Let's take a look at one more clip, and then I'm gonna have one more question, and then we're gonna take your questions.
I was gonna ask you, Martin, if it'd be possible not to use my real name when you write the story. Perhaps you could call me Nancy. I've always loved that name, Nancy. I have a niece called Nancy. Oh, no, maybe they think it's her. What about Anne Boleyn? That's a lovely name. Well, somebody had that.
We're going to have to use your real name, Philomena. That's the way these things work.
These clips are just brief teasers. They're just little tidbits. They're not extended scenes.
Actually, that was rather interesting, because there was a different joke about Anne Boleyn before, wasn't there?
Judy didn't want to do the line.
Then it deviated. I mean, this is to do with the writing. And then there was... I remember you writing a bit about where she could call herself Vivian Leigh.
That's right, yeah.
And that was going to lead to trouble. And then somehow she was persuaded to do this version of the Anne Boleyn joke. So really, you're arguing about, you know, jokes.
Who persuaded her?
She was nervous that she was worried that it was too patronizing to Philomena to make her quite so foolish. But I just thought it was funny that to say something like, I think somebody already has that name, Anne Boleyn, which just, because it's something that she sort of half remembered and wasn't quite sure where it was from. But she was anxious about it sounding too stupid. But there's a version of it. But eventually she said, "Oh, shall I?" She said, "I'll try that line." And because I sort of half interrupted, she made it work by having it as if she was thinking aloud and making the connection herself and saying, "Oh no, well somebody has that name," and then I interrupt her. So it's slightly more subtle. It's not quite as heavy-handed. But she was anxious about that. There's a line on the plane she was nervous about, which she didn't want to say, and I asked her to do one for where she says on the plane she says there's some ex-politician that comes to talk to me as Martin and she says I think he needs a good swipe of shite and she didn't want to say that. She thought that was too coarse for her. She's far more foul. She swears like a docker, but coarse for the character. And but then she tried. So, you know, and I wanted it to be slightly shocking. I wanted it to be slightly coarse at that point because it's surprising. Because I wanted it was important that the audience occasionally are wrong foot, slightly surprised. Because the audience, of course, we deliberately wanted to poke fun at Philomena and in the first act so that the audience are lulled into this sense of, which in a way is bordering on caricature, and that's a dangerous thing to play, but we have to do that to make the audience sort of make this judgment about her, like, oh, we know who she is, we know what she is, and then pull the rug from under the audience's feet by showing that there's more to her than meets the eye. But that means in some ways playing with the character and possibly, you know, stopping just short of her being caricatured. But she managed to make it she did say the line eventually, swipe and shite. Because we needed to have those tiny moments where the audience go, that's a bit shocking. But maybe we don't entirely know who she is. And as the film unfolds,
we reveal
more about her. And because, as we all do, and there's more to her than meets the eye. In fact, some audiences said when she's very comfortable with the fact that Anthony was gay and she finds this out, some audiences thought that was invention on our part, but she was entirely, because the real Philomena isn't a caricature. She's someone who is in some ways like a lot of old Irish ladies, but then when you get to know her, there are things about her which are more, you know, nuanced and more three-dimensional. So, and that we want, that's what we sort of do with the film is you know, have her reveal herself as the film goes on.
One more question for Mr. Stephen Frears, and I was just thinking about it so I've been watching your movies for, I guess, almost 30 years now, My Beautiful Laundrette being the first of your films that I saw. How many people have seen My Beautiful Laundrette? If you haven't seen it, how many people have not seen it yet? You need to rush out and check it out.
Take them out and have them shot, I would.
We let you in anyway, but now you have to go see it. But I would never have thought, I'm provoked by your comment earlier that you don't believe in auteurs. Not that I would have necessarily, if I sat back and thought about 30 years of films by you, that I don't know whether I would have applied that brand to you or not, but to hear you say so emphatically that you don't believe in the auteur theory is very striking to me, so I'm curious to hear more about that.
When I made My Beautiful Laundrette, I knew nothing about Pakistan. It was written by Hanif Qureshi, who had a father who was Pakistani and a mother who was English. It was the first time I'd come across a Pakistani in England. You know, I was a white imperialist before then. I quite possibly still am. And so suddenly this man walked in and brought me a complete world, which was very, very interesting. Just as he walked in and brought me a complete world, which I then found interesting. Well, I don't... You know, that's what I do. Somebody comes to me and says, would you like to make a film about this world? And you say, oh, and you go off it and on a new adventure.
Well, Stephen's canon of work is very eclectic. It's not.
Yes, but consistent in it is a sort of, or what I hope is a sense of curiosity, and it's made my life very, very interesting. But curiosity is much more powerful than anything more obviously associated with what they now call auteurism.
Okay, so let's switch gears, and we're going to take some questions from the audience. So we're going to go here to the gentleman in the second row, because his hand was up first, and we're just going to wait for the microphone. So here it comes. And then we'll go from there, and then we'll go up here. Okay.
Thanks. So I see the connection you're making with American comedy. Like, you look at Sturges, like Sullivan's Travels, and you have the mixture of social commentary and comedy, which works very well as a contrast. Now, the writing of the script, the story was great, and to have you direct it. Can you explain how Judi Dench got brought into it? Because she's such a pivotal character, and it's perfect.
Well, Judi was attached to this before Stephen, and I asked, I got in touch with her agent, but my co-producer, Gabby Tanner, said, what about Judi Dench for this part? And I thought, oh, that's who we should aim for, that's the first choice. Because she's become known in her life for these matriarchal characters, but in actual fact, she spent 50 years being a character actress on the stage and on television. And I pointed out to Marius, I said that she played Iris Murdoch, and she's not always these middle-class white sort of strong characters, that she can be play very different things. And I hoped that it would appeal to her. We spoke to her agent. I told her the story, her agent's story, that we were halfway through writing. And she said, go to Judy's house and tell her the story. So I went to her house and knocked on the door. She made me a cup of tea and I told her the story. And she said, I said, are you interested? She said, yes, I'm very interested. And it appealed to her. She has an Irish ancestry, and it appealed to her as an actor because it wasn't more of the same for her. But at that point, we then, knowing that we had her probably going to play Philomena, we then wrote things that we knew she'd be able to. There's a couple of scenes in there where she goes to revisit the last time she saw Anthony. When she goes to the Abbey, and she retraces her steps, and it's the camera, and it's just on her face. And then watching the video at the end, where Stephen goes in really close, we were writing it, we thought it would be great to have these moments of her alone with her own private thoughts, and no one else being privy to that apart from the audience watching, because there's no other characters, no one can see her face at those moments apart from the audience. No other characters in the story can see her face. So. And knowing that we had her, we knew that she'd be able to, that her face would people be able to read things on her face, because she's of that caliber that she can sort of do apparently nothing and it would still communicate something. So we sort of tailored it to her once she was attached.
One might want to assume that this woman is intimidating. I mean, her name is Dame Judi Dench. She's an actress of tremendous acclaim.
The Americans are very impressed by titles and stuff like that. We don't give a shit about it, frankly.
So she was just like any other. Yeah. Very good. Okay, so let's see. We're going to go. There's a question here, and then we're going to go here, and then there was a woman in the back. Yes, hi.
Hello, my name is Kat, and I'm an NYU student at Tisch, and I haven't had the pleasure of seeing the film yet, but I would love to go into it having an opinion of yours, Steve, in my mind. And I was wondering if you talk about a part of your character that you felt closest to, I guess, maybe because of like a personal experience or a part of yourself that you related to this character with, or that'd be great. Thanks.
Well, I don't think you should go in with an
lapsed Catholic.
Yeah, I'm a lapsed Catholic, basically. And and also, that's a true story. Martin Sixsmith, whom I play in the film, I spoke to him
spoke to the actual person.
The script
interviewed
was made from talking to Philomena and talking to Martin.
Right.
and asking them questions, and that informed a large part of the script.
Right.
I was very keen to sort of to find out their thoughts, and only part of it was based on Martin's book. Really, most of it was gleaned from conversations. Mm-hmm. But I sort of used his character to put a lot of my own stuff in there about Catholicism and about religion, and use that as an opportunity to. I wanted to have a conversation. In a way, in some ways, it's like an open letter to my parents. I couldn't have a conversation with them about Catholicism, so I'll just make a film instead, and that would be a way of doing it. Yeah, because I wanted to have this because I have a complicated relationship with it, and I'm not a Catholic. But there is something about people who have that stoic, simple faith that I respect, and so I wanted to get stuff off my chest, and also recognize that there's something that's still important about it that perhaps I don't fully understand. And Philomena dignifies it at the end of the film by her forgiveness.
Don't ruin it.
I have to ask the follow up to that. You went and met the Pope.
Yes. Yeah.
So being someone who is not only a lapsed Catholic, but you don't define yourself. You have this relationship with Catholicism. How was that? How was that experience?
I didn't get into that with him. I introduced Philomena to the Pope last week because.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, we were there on behalf of a charity called the Philomena Project, which is built on the back of the film, with an organization in Ireland called the Adoption Alliance, which helps people like Philomena, who had their children forcibly adopted in the past, helps them trace where their children are, and also helps the children of those unwed mothers who were shamed by the church back in the day, help them find their mothers. So to help them track them down. So part of that was to bring pressure on the Irish government, and the Pope had heard of the film, and his advisors had told him to come meet us, and so. We went there at the invitation of the Pope because he'd heard about this charity, and the conversation's really about how we could bring pressure to bear on the Irish government to make some changes, because at the moment there's a kind of an ambivalence. They sort of want it all to go away because it's an embarrassment, and we want to have the government change the law so people have access to information and the rights to access to information as you have here in the US and we have in the UK, but Ireland doesn't. So that's what it was about. And the Pope was very nice.
Very nice.
Well, the Vatican, we screened the film in the Vatican in their screening room, and his...
You sound so calm about it. I can't imagine.
It was quite... I had to introduce it and I had to say, look, you know, this film is very critical of the church, but... You know, but I think the religion itself, the Catholicism itself, is dignified through the character of Philomena at the end, and therefore, you know, we throw them a bone, as it were, or an olive branch, is the more eloquent way of putting it. But they said that they were, the Pope's senior advisor said this is entirely in keeping with the tone of it, the film, with the message of Pope Francis, which is. A more nuanced, forgiving, compassionate message, and less preoccupied with dogma, right. We were pleased.
Very good. Okay, we're going to go into the front row, and then we're going to go to the back. Yes.
I was very satisfied. This was an article I read in the newspaper 4 years ago. And I wondered if I could do something with it. It moved me, and I found it. I made me angry. But in the two characters, I saw an opportunity. I have to say, I optioned Martin's book without having read it. And when I did read it, his book is all about the life of Anthony in America, and that wasn't really the story I wanted to tell. So I had to go to him and say I wanted to make him, the author, a character in the story. And talk more about his relationship with Philomena and their search. So, it wasn't really much of an adaptation. It was more or less an entirely original screenplay with about 20% of the book in it, I'd say. But it was incredibly satisfying to have something that was just for me in career terms. It was the first time I've ever done something not on the basis of advice from people around me, agents or managers or anyone else. I just did it because I wanted to do it, and I hoped that it would work. And so I feel I have a nice sense of vindication at this point.
Very good. We have a few more minutes for a few more questions. Yes, all the way in the back. Hi.
Lovely, lovely film. You worked the balance so well between the comedy and the drama that you spoke of earlier. My question is, now I know you said you spoke to Philomena. Did you, in any way, in any part of the creative process, speak to any women, whether it was to look at the script or in any way? I noticed that the story is mostly through Martin. There were a few moments in the film where I did feel a woman's point of view was missing. And being that the script was written by two men and directed by a man, I just wondered if at any point you brought that sensibility in.
My co-producer is Gabby Tanner, is a woman, or she was the last time I looked. And and she gave us some very, very incisive comments. I wasn't preoccupied with I want to get a woman's point of view, but Gabby gave her point of view vociferously throughout the process, and Philomena spoke to us, and I asked her questions, and often what ended up on the screen were her words, all the stuff about the laundry, her feelings about having a son taken from her. We're all sort of from her point of view, but to say that I specifically thought, should I get more women's points of view on this? No, I didn't. I mean, I just spoke to Philomena, who's a woman, and my co-producer, who's a woman, and their input is in there.
Okay, so we're here in the second row now.
Yes, congratulations on a fantastic movie. What I wanted to ask you was what really touched you and inspired you to write the story? Was it simply because of sort of the injustice of the laundries? Was it the wonderful surprise as to who her son turned out to be? Like, what about her story? I know you said you read an article. You wanted to tell the story from the perspective of the relationship between Mr. Sixsmith and Philomena, but what exactly was that little nugget that touched you?
The nugget that touched me was, as I was reading the article out loud to my then girlfriend here in New York 4 years ago, and I was doing a slightly less intelligent studio comedy film. I was actually what really moved me was the fact that it was a story about love and that connection between a mother and her child, and the fact that he did have himself buried at Ross Cray in the hope that one day she'd find him, so that there would still be that hope that there'd be a connection even in after his death, and that that he would show his love even after his death. And that was so profoundly moving and touching, and within that sort of a kind of a hopefulness that I wanted to find the show, because it was both tragic and touching, and somehow in spite of it all uplifting too. And I really wanted to and I did think that because it was about a mother and her son, and about a woman who was actually in some ways could be anyone's mother or anyone's grandmother, there's something remarkable about her, but also something unremarkable about her. And I thought that would resonate with people because it was not it wasn't about a seismic event. It was just a small story in a way. But it was the main part of it. It was the fact that this grand gesture, the idea of people being connected with each other even though they're apart.
Thank you.
Okay, let's go. We're almost out of time. Let's go to a question here in the front row.
You kind of just answered this, but you said earlier that you didn't want to tell the story of Anthony's life in America. I was wondering, what made you decide on which bit of the whole saga to focus on as a writer?
There's a film called Missing with Sissy Spacek and Jack Lemmon, and I always forget the name of the director. Thank you. Yeah. And I knew that you could tell a story about two people looking for someone who they don't physically necessarily find in the way that you think they're going to. And so I knew that was a possible way of telling the story. I wanted it to be straightforward. And also I wanted to tell it through Philomena's eyes so that because information and everything was always beyond her reach, beyond Philomena tried to find information, it was always beyond her reach. And so there's lots of glimpsing of nuns at the end of corridors and through windows. And then also Anthony's life was beyond reach. So we have those snatches of Super 8 film and everything of his life. That was all in the script, that idea of these glimpses and snatches of his life. And so I didn't want to have, firstly because it would make the story more straightforward, to not want to try and tell two stories at once, but also because her experience of his life was like that. She didn't know it, so it's always out of reach. And I wanted to see his life from her point of view. And suddenly at the end, she sees his life on videotape, or all at once on a box. And that's what happened, that's the truth. So it was more interesting, I think, to tell her story than his. I mean, his story is an interesting story, but that's a different, someone might want to tell that story, but I was more interested in her journey. And also the fact that it was his intellect versus her intuition, and the idea that she seems to have a better understanding of life than Martin does, with all his education and so-called, enlightenment. And that paradox fascinated me, because I know people like Philomena and I know people like Martin.